Hello everyone, I'm Dario, I'm a PhD student at the University of Turin and the Astrophysical Observatory of Turin in Italy. And in this presentation I'm going to talk about the DIMS project, which as a target also meteors observation, but also something more peculiar, which I'm going to introduce you in the first slide, about some exotic particles that might resemble meteors. And then we will talk about the instrument and the instrument calibration, which was personally my work on this project, and the first analysis of meteors and conclusion if these kind of exotic particles were observed up to now or not. So as you know, or as you may know, there is something called dark matter, which explains for in reality quite my majority of the matter in the universe. And there are several observational and indirect evidence for dark matter. For example, the behavior of galaxies in their rotation profile, in the cosmic background anisotropics, etc. And there are also many dark matter candidates, especially particle dark matter candidates. For example, neutrinos, weakly interactive massive particles, etc. As up to now, there is no prevailing candidate between a very large class of dark matter candidates. And what is commonly put on the plate is that a suitable dark matter candidate should have a small interaction cross-section with other matter. But this hypothesis is relaxed if the particle is massive enough, and so this class of dark matter candidates is called for this reason macroscopic dark matter. And this hypothesis in reality took place the first time in 1984 when Witten hypothesized the strange dwarf matter, which is matter made by up-down and strange dwarfs mainly, may be more stable than ordinary matter. In reality, may be the ground state of ordinary matter. So that following this intuition, the Rugula and Glashow in the same year followed up with a theoretical description of such heavy particles, heavy lumps of strange dwarf matter with the Earth atmosphere. These objects are named nuclearites, were named nuclearites by the authors. And as we will see now, they are supposed to have a similar interaction and phenomenology with respect to meteors, with some major discriminants, but okay. In reality, this first hypothesis of nuclearites developed up until now in a wide range of hypothetical dark matter candidates for macroscopic dark matter, and is referred as macroscopic dark matter. Okay, so in this table, I've listed the main features of meteors and what is expected to be a nuclearite. And we know for meteors from the solar system, the speed is bounded between 11 and 72 kilometers per second, whereas nuclearites are supposed to have much higher speeds value. Which this value which range from the meteor range to up to 550 kilometers per second are taking into account the rotation of the galaxy. So these are the order of magnitude of the speeds, and as a mean value is always taken 250 kilometers per second. So if this is true, even if nuclearites can have speeds within the meteor range, it is not common. So this should be a first discriminant between the two events, let's say, observed in the Earth atmosphere. Another discriminant is the altitude of the event within the atmosphere, which for nuclearites is supposed to be very low respect to meteors, so usually below 30 kilometers, as a consequence of density and the speed itself and the mass of this kind of object. And what is, I think, the most peculiar things is that, of course, meteors move downwards, but nuclearites may also move upwards, because in fact they can traverse the whole Earth, and come up from the ground to leave the Earth going upward. And as a matter of fact, if the their mass is small enough, we are talking about nanograms in this case, they should also accumulate within the Earth crust and not leave the Earth. And another feature is the light curve, which is, I mean, varies for meteors, but usually with an increase and then a sudden decrease. But light curves from this, from nuclear event, is supposed to be quite flat. So with no particular features like flares and et cetera. So DIMS is an acronym for Dark Matter Interstellar Meteorite Study, and is a project dedicated to the investigation of macros and interstellar meteors, as the name says, their flux at the Earth. So in summary, it wants to deal with the observation of fast-moving objects in the atmosphere. And for this requirement, also remembering that nuclearites are supposed to happen in a lower range of altitude, usually meteor observations are carried out in a way that the various nodes of the network are far from each other, tens of kilometers. Because the triangulation happened, and the meteor happened at about 100 kilometers of altitude. But in nuclearite cases, we are looking at events in a lower range, so the cameras are much closer to one another. So this is the instrumental setup. We use a Canon monochrome camera and a CMOS sensor, which is full HD resolution, and operating at almost 30 frames per second. So DIMS carried out several observations since 2017. And we are now reaching the part of fully operation with an automated system and continuous monitoring, but up to 2021, let's say, so up to this year, the DIMS project carried out standalone observations, and I'm going to focus on one of these, and this is the observation of the 1st September 2019 at the Telescope Array site, so in the USA, and with two cameras, which are named N1 and N2, and this is the map of the site. So the two cameras were installed here and here, so they are 16 kilometers away from each other. So not optimal for meteor triangulation, but optimal for nuclear triangulation. And we detected about 400 coincident events, let's say, because we are not supposing that all of these are meteors. And this is an example of the coincident event, of one coincident event. And this is the camera box developed for the observations. And this is an example of the video. So let me, I don't know if I can, yes, I can. Okay, so this is just a meteor and just an example of our data. Okay, so of course the first task that we processed is the calibration of the sensor. So the cameras are pointed toward Polaris with a wide field of view of about 57 times 34 degrees and a scale of about 1.8 arcminutes per pixel. So the videos are very short. They are triggered, sorry, I forgot to mention, they are triggered by UFO capture, and the video are just a few seconds as a mean value. And so the astronomer is performing the medium frame also to arise signal to noise ratio. And we use the standard Pockhorst catalog for reference. And the approach is similar to the one developed for another kind of observation, so Prisma or Sky cameras. The reason is that I work also on Prisma network, so I adapted the algorithm also for this project. Of course, this is not the same algorithm because Prisma deals with all sky cameras, and this is not an all sky, instead it's a wide field of view. So similar to Prisma, then the distortion is quite important, but we managed to deal it with a standard CD matrix approach with a very high 8-degree polynomial distortion. And the result is that we can identify about 900 stars per image. It depends, of course, in mind to 4 stars of about plus 8. And since the camera is pointed toward Polaris, we can work directly with right ascension and declination. It's very easy. And then we obtain a standard residual of about 0.15 pixel, which is quite below pixel resolution, so good. And about photometry, we have to deal with a wide band pass photometry. And for this purpose, we at some point we figured out that the Hipparcos magnitude has a quite similar band pass to ours. It's a little bit narrower in the extrema, but it's quite similar. So we use the Hipparcos magnitude for the calibration, and we achieved a standard deviation of residuals. This is plotted as a function of the Hermas of about 0.3 magnitude. So, sorry, the question is misplaced. And we also perform calibration of DIMS cameras within a large integrated sphere at the National Institute of Polar Research in Japan. And we were able to correct for the efficiency. It is proved that in this case, the deficiency is at a maximum, the center of the camera, this is the radius, and decrease down to 30% at the very border. So this has to be taken into account for the magnitude estimation following the meteor if it's quite long in the field of view. And we, of course, with the two cameras, triangulated the events by standard line of sight method by Borovitska, and computed the magnitude point by point. This is an example of the results. As you can see, for example, that there is a time shift between the two cameras, which can be seen quite well from the triangulation. And this is known because the two cameras were manually synchronized in time, but not automatically during the whole session, observative session. So, but for example, if you plot as a function of the altitude, this is no more a problem. And then, for example, this is the speed and the magnitude. And so some first results of the meteor analysis, and then we are going back to the first, the beginning of our argument, so nuclear ice and dark matter. And so we found a limiting magnitude for meteors of about plus 6, which is a little brighter than the limiting magnitude for stars, but this is to be expected. And going to the question, none of the analyzed events showed some kind of feature that would point out a non-meteor object. So no event at a low altitude from ground. And this is the plot of the altitude reconstructed, the histogram. So all between 70 and 130. 8 events had a speed greater than the boundary meteors from the solar system, but they were discarded as they were inspected visually one by one. They were found to be badly reconstructed from triangulation because they had, let's say, 3 points, 4 points, and that's it. And they were thought to be not very reliable for the reconstruction. And for what meteors are concerned, they showed the typical bivariate distribution for velocity, and this is the absolute magnitude plot, and we can see the limited magnitude I was talking about as the first point. So since we didn't detect any event that could resemble a nuclearite, this negative, let's say, conclusion can be turned out in a positive conclusion. So putting constraints on macros flux. Okay. This is something that was already done by several authors. For example, one author, Sidhu and Starkman, considered the full dataset of the desert fiber network and put constraints on the macros flux. And in this plot, you can see the phase space of the parameters for macros, which can be resembled by the mass and the cross section. And if you consider the limiting magnitude, which can be turned in mass for nuclearites, and or macros in more general way, you can rule out some part of this parameter space. There are two plots because there are two models in reality for the description of nuclearites or macros. And the original one from the Rukul and Glasho, the one I mentioned earlier, and another one which consider a slightly different dynamic for nuclearites in the atmosphere, which is from Sidhu and Starkman. And they, in reality, they differ quite from orders of magnitude in reality. And the result that in one case we can rule out a portion of the parameter space only with our observation, which was the base of 7 hours of observation, and then we can have a projection for, let's say, 1 year of operation of our instrument, and this is this. And in the other case, from the newer model, let's say, we cannot rule out anything with 7 hours of observations, but we can plot the projection from 1 year. Okay, so as a conclusion, so nuclearites and macros are potential candidates for dark matter. They are interesting because they would produce meteor-like events in some way in the Earth atmosphere, but they feature peculiar observational characteristics, such as the very high speed and the low altitudes from ground or the upward motion. So they can be, they should be recognized from, apart from meteors. So the DIMS project is dedicated to the observation of such fast objects. And this work dealt with the characterization of our of the DIMS system and its potentiality for dark matter. And so what's next is to assess, for example, the trigger efficiency for fine magnitudes, which deal with the last consideration, complete the analysis of the world data set, and hopefully going to full operational mode with improved hardware and remote control so that we can maybe achieve the 1 year projection we were talking about. So thank you for your attention.